A very warm welcome to each and every one today. This is Reflections, our devotional Bible study. Our series is presently called Songs of the Savior. We're looking at the very first Christmas carols as we discover in the book of Luke. We had Zechariah's song and Mary's song. Today it's the song of the angels from Luke chapter 2. If you have a Bible and like to turn there. It's very appropriate we sing our first hymn is Hark the Herald Angels Sing. And oftentimes the first verse goes, Hark the Herald Angels Sing, Glory to the Newborn King. We're going to change newborn to coming and also end it with Glory to the Coming King, because not only did Jesus come the first time, he's coming again the second time. So we're just honoring the coming of Christ with this great carol.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the coming King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies, with angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the coming King. Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. Late in time behold him come, offspring of a virgin's womb, veiled in flesh the Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity, pleased as man with man to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the coming King. Hail the hen-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness, life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he'll face his glory by, born that man no more may die, born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the coming.
Truly one of the great hymns of the faith by Charles Wesley. It's packed with biblical truth in all three verses. And that is a whole sermon series and message in its own right. Hark the herald angels sing. Well, we pick it up in Luke chapter 2, a very familiar story in verse 8. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them. The glory of the Lord shone around them. They are terrified. The angel said, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you, Christ the Lord. This will be a sign. You'll find a baby wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger." And suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." There was a Sunday school teacher asked her preschoolers, "Can you name an angel in the Christmas story?" Little Mindy says, "I only know the names of one angel, and he's called Harold. And mommy sings to me the Christmas carol, Hark the Herald Angel Sings." Well, you got to love the joy of little children. Today, the song of the angels, better known as the Glory in Excelsis. And we will sing that phrase to conclude our time today in that great hymn, Angels We Have Heard on High. Let me just make some observations about the scripture I just read. You see, shepherding had lost its luster in the first century. Shepherds made up the lowest class of people, coming ahead just of the lepers. In the Talmud, which is a collection of interpretations and insights from the rabbis, it says, "No help is to be given to heathen or shepherds." How's that for love? Thank you very much. So they were religious outcasts. According to Jewish religious law, these shepherds were unclean. Their job prevented them from participating in feasts and holy days of the Jewish religious calendar. And when everyone else is making the trip to Jerusalem to make sacrifices at the temple or to participate in an annual feast, of course, they were out in the fields. Now, it wasn't their fault, but they were looked down on, certainly from a religious point of view. And that takes place today in our world and culture in various ways as well. They were also looked on with suspicion, maybe the way people today might look at door-to-door salesmen, gypsies, carnival workers. They were often accused of being thieves. Now, if something came up missing, I bet a shepherd did it. They weren't permitted to give testimony in legal proceedings. Their word wasn't considered trustworthy. They were religious outcasts, looked on with suspicion. I imagine it was also a very lonely profession. Gave them a lot of contact with sheep, but very little exposure to people. No wonder David, the shepherd who became king, was such an accomplished musician. Many learned to play the flute or other instrument. They certainly had plenty of time on their hands. But who understood the idea of sacrifice better than the shepherds? Do you realize how close Bethlehem is to Jerusalem? I'll tell you next week. I'm just kidding. They were just a few miles apart. Sheep raised were used as sacrifices in the temple at Jerusalem. Yearly, every Jewish family came to Jerusalem to offer sacrifices in the temple for their sins. Animals sacrificed were generally a lamb. They didn't bring a sacrificial lamb along with them. They waited until they got to Jerusalem and bought a lamb there to use as a sacrifice. You know, lambing season in Israel is generally February and March. Interesting timing, since lambing season corresponds with the Jewish celebration of Passover. Every family was to sacrifice a year-old lamb as a sin offering. You know, in Jesus' day, anywhere from, get this, 135,000 to 270,000 lambs were sacrificed every single year at Passover. So now, while shepherds are doing their job, an angel appeared and the glory of the Lord shone around them. You know, today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you, the Messiah, the Lord. Shepherds would be the first to see Jesus, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. And then suddenly, the great company of heavenly hosts appeared, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." The word "suddenly" means unexpected, without warning. It's kind of like at times I may be coming down to the bluffs unexpectedly, without warning, there's a deer that pops out right in front of me. Great company means that there were so many it was impossible to count. And these heavenly hosts refer to the Lord's army in other passages of Scripture. Now, this song is different because it came down from heaven as opposed to from within a person like Zacharias or Mary. That burst within those two, but this came down from heaven. So what grace from God for the angel to appear to these shepherds, these outcasts, these ones who were looked on with suspicion, those who were very lonely, and have the privilege of being the first to come and see the Messiah. That is grace. Then they talk about peace on earth. Now, yeah, I know, wait a minute, Chaplain, something's wrong here. Because over recorded history of 4,000 years, only 300 years have been without a major war. You know, someone said, peace is that brief, glorious moment in history when everyone stops to reload their weapons. One of my favorite hymns by Longfellow is I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day. And he wrote that with the Civil War in full swing. The Battle of Gettysburg had occurred only 6 months earlier. And one of the phrases goes, and in despair I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth, I said, for hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. Chaplain, were the angels wrong? Not at all. You see, peace comes on earth by grace to one heart at a time. And that peace also came to those shepherds. So after the angels sang, it says, when the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in the manger. When they'd seized him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. Now Mary treasured these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, I love this, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. So no doubt that grace of God, that blessing of heaven rested in them, in their hearts, that peace of Christ. Now, I like to just focus on the word peace for a moment, because we just sang in Hark the Herald Angels Sing too, Hail the Heaven-Born Prince of Peace. You know, and the angels spoke about peace. Jesus is peace because he is the Prince of Peace. And there is a Trinitarian nature of peace. There's peace with God that's an upward, grace-filled experience. Paul said in Romans, we're justified through faith. We have peace with God through Jesus Christ. So, Jesus obviously had to be born. He was born to be that sacrificial lamb. God, yet man, the sinless Son of God, shed his blood on the cross, rose victoriously. That's why we can have peace with God. God the Father poured out his wrath on his Son, who died on our place as a sin substitute. I like what Billy Graham said. He said, the greatest warfare going on in the world is between man and God. People may not realize they're at war with God, but if they don't know Jesus as their Savior, God considers them to be at war with him. Now, if life's a puzzle, Jesus is the missing P-E-A-C-E. Think of it this way. You know, the Bible teaches, and what we profess as Christians, the only way to peace with God, to stop that war with the Father, is Jesus Christ. So how does the world respond? Oh, you're the most narrow-minded, prejudiced people who've ever lived. Well, how do we answer the world? Well, this illustration may help. Say you go to the doctor. He tests your blood and says, you know, you have diabetes. I've got good news. You can take insulin. You'll probably have to take it the rest of your life, but it'll permit you to live a pretty much normal life. And you say, I don't want to take insulin. Why can't I take aspirin instead or penicillin? And the doctor explains, you know, insulin is the only thing that will help. Well, doctor, you're the most narrow-minded and prejudiced person I have ever seen. Well, he's just being loving and compassionate because the only thing that will help or save you is insulin. He's just telling you the truth. And that's why we share the good news of peace with God that comes only through Jesus Christ. The world fusses and fumes and, oh, there's this way or that philosophy or this religion or this truth. No, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. There's only one way. You know, if we confess with our lips Jesus is Lord and believe in our heart, God will, we will be saved. That Jesus was raised from the dead will be saved. Just as insulin saves a person's life, how much more so does Jesus, the Savior, save our life? Who needs your prayers for peace with God? Keep praying. It's not over until that last breath. So yeah, there's peace with God. There's also the peace of God, which is a continual experience for the believer. Paul said to the Philippians, the peace of God surpasses all comprehension. Paul said to Thessalonians, the Lord of peace continually grants you peace in every circumstance. A resident told me one time, oh, please say prayers of peace for us. We're grieving. We need God's comfort. I want to share a true story. Her name is Stella Thornhope. She was struggling with her first Christmas alone. Her husband died a few months prior with a slow developing cancer. She felt terribly alone and decided she wasn't going to decorate. Late that afternoon, the doorbell rang. A delivery boy with a box. Inside, a little puppy, a gold Labrador retriever. He's 6 weeks old, completely housebroken. A young man handed her an envelope. Her husband wrote it 3 weeks before he died. He left it with the kennel owner to be delivered with the puppy as his last Christmas gift to her. The letter was filled with love and encouragement, admonition to be strong. And he vowed he was waiting for the day when she would join him. She wiped away the tears, picked up the golden furry ball and held it to her neck. At that moment, she heard the radio in the kitchen playing, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. And you know, she suddenly felt the most amazing sensation of peace rushing over her. She said, little fella, it's just you and me. You know what? There's a box down in the basement. It's got a little Christmas tree and decorations. There's a manger scene down there. How about we go get it? Oh, at that moment, in the midst of her grief, she needed the peace of God. Where in your life do you need the peace of God? I experienced amazing peace. I was with my mom when she breathed her last, and I also experienced what Stella did, this amazing sensation of God's peace and presence right at that moment. That is peace for the believer. God has peace for us in the midst of grief, in the midst of our health, in the midst of every circumstance. But that's based on the relationship we have with God. We have peace with God and Jesus Christ. That's why we can have the peace of God in every circumstances. Then the final one, we have peace for others, which is for our relationships. Paul said the Romans make every effort to do what leads to peace and mutual edification. Lucy said to Charlie Brown, I hate everybody in the whole world. Charlie said, but I thought you had inner peace. Oh, I do, but I still have outer obnoxiousness. Little girl was working diligently on her homework when her father asked her what she was doing. She looked up at her dad and replied, I'm writing a report on how to bring peace to the world. Father smiled and said, isn't that a pretty big order for a little girl? Little girl answered, oh, no, don't worry, Daddy. There are three of us in the class working on it. Well, nobody said it was easy, but it is our calling as a Christian, as the body of Christ. You see, when we have peace with God and the peace of God, we have the potential to have peace for others. I'd like to close our reflection with another amazing story of peace as it relates to three individuals from World War II. Mitsuo Fuchida led the largest airborne naval assault in history, 350 planes on Pearl Harbor. Before it was all over, the death count would reach 2,400 lives. Well, General Jimmy Doolittle was chosen to lead a daring daytime bombing raid over Tokyo. The bombers ran out of fuel, and they're unable to make it to the friendly Chinese airstrips. Most of the pilots are forced to bail out over hostile Japanese-held territory. Now, one of those who bailed out was Jake DeShazer. He was held in a prisoner of war camp for nearly 4 years. During that time, he was beaten and mistreated. He had a fierce and passionate hatred. But while in prison, he's able to read the Bible for the first time in his life. As he read the story of Jesus, the message of forgiveness seemed to overwhelm him. By his own testimony, in one transforming moment, all the anger and hatred was gone. He started loving his Japanese guards. He returned to Japan as a missionary after the war. Well, in 1950, Mitsuo Fuchida rode the train to Tokyo, where someone handed him a piece of paper. It was Jake DeShazer's story of faith in Christ entitled, "I Was a Prisoner of Japan." So as Mitsuo read that, as a Buddhist, it was all new to him. He was so enthralled by the story of Jesus Christ. And he said, "The many men I had killed and slaughtered in the name of patriotism, I did not understand the love which Christ wants to implant within every human heart. Right at that moment, I seemed to meet Jesus for the first time. I understood the meaning of his death as a substitute for my wickedness. I asked him to forgive my sin and change me from a bitter, disillusioned ex-pilot into a well-balanced Christian with purpose in living." The third person, Joe Morgan, was a 19-year-old kid from Brockton, Texas, who survived Pearl Harbor. After the war, became a preacher. You know where his first church was? Hawaii. By his own testimony, he struggled for years with hatred for the Japanese people. Years passed, he was still a pastor in Oahu, eaten up with anger and bitterness. Guess who came to speak? Mitsuo Fuchida at a local church. Well, with great skepticism, Joe went to hear him. Well, afterward, he confronted Fuchida and told him he'd been on the ground at Pearl Harbor. And Mitsuo Fuchida bowed slightly, very gently said, Gominasai, which means, "I'm sorry." And as Joe reached out to shake his hand, he said, Mitsuo reached out to shake Joe's hand, he experienced the miracle of a lifetime. The anger and hatred were gone. "God had let me forgive," he said. Joe would later become a chaplain for the Pearl Harbor Survivors Association. 50 years after attack in 1991, President Bush spoke at the National Cemetery of the Pacific. Joe Morgan gave the invocation. Is there such a thing as peace on earth? Absolutely. One heart at a time. It was a peace with, of, and for. It was a peace that touched a Japanese pilot, Mitsuo Fuchida. It's a peace of God that changed the lives of a prisoner of war by the name of Jake DeShazer, so that message of forgiveness could reach Mitsuo. And then Mitsuo, whose life was changed, could touch the life of a soldier who was there at Pearl Harbor and survive the attack. Now, if that's not the grace of God, I don't know what is. Question, who needs extra support in your relationships? You have peace with God in Christ, peace right now to make it through whatever any situation you might be in. Is there someone in your sphere of influence that needs a prayer of peace or forgiveness or a blessing? They just need to know that they're loved and appreciated. You might be the only person's prayers who reach heaven on their behalf. So thank God He has a plan for you, a purpose for you. That's why He blessed you with this peace in the first place. That's why we can live each day as a loved and forgiven child of God, not just for us, but for others, for the staff, another resident, for our families, children, grandchildren. It's that gift that lives on. Well, let's close with another great hymn, Angels We Have Heard on High.
Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plain, and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strain. Gloria in excelsis Deo, Gloria in excelsis Deo. Shepherds, why this jubilee? Why your joyous strains prolong? What the gladsome tidings be which inspire heavenly song? Gloria in excelsis Deo, Gloria in excelsis Deo. Shepherds, why this up to Bethlehem and see Him whose birth the angels sing. Come adore on bended knee Christ the Lord, that new coming King. Gloria in excelsis Deo,
may the message of the angels to the shepherds to us today, yes, we say, hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace. Well, may that grace and peace of God be multiplied unto you today and the days to come until we meet again.